kind of qualities. But about the stream computing, I mean, this is where I think that IBM is doing some kind of pioneer work. So InfoSphere Stream, I mean, that is a new product which is having, we have around it, I mean, we have launched it, and that is actually about that. About our Smarter City campaign, and we are talking about all the information things. So that's one area that we would like to talk about. So what are the different problems that we talk about? It is about the about the fraud that is happening in big data, right? It is about the IT log analysis, right? So how can we know that a particular server will fail in another few moments? So processing terabytes of data every day and figuring out that when a server can fail, can we predict that, right? Another big thing, I mean, since I am from the government industry, so I am talking about, I would like to cite that. That is about the citizen sentiment analysis, right? As you know, that governments are moving, and they need to move closer to the citizens. They need to pay attention to what citizens want, right? So Gartner, I mean, they are talking about it for last 2-3 years in their open government maturity model, right? You know, and the fourth layer, I mean, level, I mean, they are talking about the citizen sentiment analysis, right? So it's about, you know, listening to your citizens, figuring out what is working and what is not working. How can you do that? From your social media, because citizens are often very vocal about it, right? So they go over there. So I'd like to, you know, this is the typical architecture that we follow, but let us not get into this kind of technical details. We usually use a product called Cognos Consumer Insight. We have SystemT, we use Hadoop, we do not use HDFS, which is the Hadoop's file system. We use something called Original Parallel File System, which is slightly more rugged because it is usually often supports transactional aspect also, which HDFS do not often support. But it is essentially a confluence of, you know, the analytics, natural language processing, its information extraction, information retrieval, and visual analytics. And we recently, let me talk about one particular area where we recently worked on. We did a, you know, social sentiment analysis for one of the major U.S. Social services organization. Fantastic insights that we managed to reveal, discover. So we worked on, we analyzed it on two different aspects. I mean, they deliver benefits and services, and they deliver healthcare, right? So we found that the benefits and services are more talked about topic, right? And within that, I mean, the disability and compensation and employment benefits are more talked about, and mental health is another thing that is happening on the healthcare dimension. But let us look at the negative and positive sentiments, which is the most useful stuff. So the disability compensation, insurance, and pension, that is actually leading to a lot of negative sentiments within the citizens. Whereas looking at the benefits, employment benefits, home loan benefits, those are working fine. So those are evoking some positive sentiments. So that provided excellent insight to that agency. So where they need to put more focus, and et cetera, right? And we did some root cause analysis also. So we found that there are a lot of, you know, there is a huge backlog of the claims processing. So they need to put some focus towards that. And of course, they didn't have much social media strategy. So they are not listening to their people. They are not responding. So how they can do it? So ladies and gentlemen, with that, possibly I need to conclude over here. I do not think that we have time to take questions and answer, but of course, I'll be available during the lunch. So happy to take any more questions. And my email address is also here. Please shoot me a mail if you want. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Sarkar. Well, as we are running short of time, I don't think I have got much time. But anyway, I will give the floor to Mr. Shivaji Basu, Head Strategy Office, IOM, Tata Consultancy Services, to come and speak on cloud, the theme. And I will speak little about him. Mr. Basu heads the strategy office of IOM, the TCS, Cloud Computing Solution for SMES, and Senior Consultant in Manufacturing Execution System. He has a lot of other things. I am skipping that, but I lead the last one. He says he has also been actively involved in quality initiatives, being the lead corporate accessor for TCS in TBM, that is Malcolm Baldrige variant in total quality. Well, welcome, Mr. Basu. Please do come.
And thanks, Bengal Chamber, for having me here. At the outset, I will speak about cloud computing in general, not much about what TCS does in this space. I think that best serves the essence of this forum. Of course, TCS does a host of things in cloud computing, but there would be other forums where we will be able to explain that better. When we talk about cloud computing, it sounds very complex, but it is not so. Other than the fact that there has been a lot of things being spoken about cloud computing, and it can actually be simplified. So when we talk about cloud computing, there are two things or aspects to it. First is an economic aspect, and second is a technology aspect. I'll start briefly on the economic aspect. To do that, let me clarify one ambiguity that exists in the field of cloud computing. A lot of you may be having the question whether you should go for private cloud or public cloud. We believe that there's nothing called private cloud that exists. It is a term that has been coined by many marketeers, probably a kind of compromise we are trying to make to reach the cloud vision. Private cloud, what has been termed to be, is a cloud computing platform where the software is hosted by the enterprise in a central database so that there's no software that resides in the desktop. But this is nothing new. This has existed at least 25 years back. Even when we have IBM mainframes, there were applications which were running centrally, and they were used on dumb terminals. And even in those days, applications were used on paper-use basis because IBM was charging consumers on a service unit called MSU. So if we are talking about private cloud here, we are talking nothing new. So what makes sense to us is the public cloud. And there is an economic aspect to it. Public cloud essentially means that the IT is shared across multiple consumers for two reasons. One is there is a cost advantage to the consumer. Second is there is a cost advantage to the provider. But again, there is a reality. There are several players in this field who have been successful or trying to be better in the cloud computing. So we may talk about Amazon, who has done very good in the enterprise space. But did we ask the question why Amazon is doing better in the enterprise space? That is because Amazon is dealing with a IT service which is more commoditized, that is infrastructure. I will stick to the theme, overarching theme of remote infrastructure management, that is the theme of the session, and I'll come to that. But what I'm trying to say at this moment is that as IT is more commoditized, it is easier for providers to share it across many consumers. But when IT is becoming more specialized, where it is a differentiator for the consumer, like process-oriented applications like ERP, we have challenges in cloud computing. So there we have to work out a compromise. At this point in time, we claim that there will not be 100% cloud computing unless there is a hybrid strategy adopted by the adopter as well as the service provider. So what many people like Nicholas Carr has talked about, that IT can be a utility service, probably it's too ahead of time, and being very ahead of time is not a very good idea. So what everybody is doing is coming up with a hybrid strategy where cloud can complement what should be in on-premise. So I'll speak very independently as an analyst first to see what is the strategy that is coming out in the market. So we have our understanding of what Microsoft is doing, what Apple is doing, what Google is doing, and we work with all of them. At the same time, we have our own products. But keeping that aside, let us come to how the ecosystem is developing in this competitive environment and what value is being passed on to the consumer. So if you look at Microsoft, Microsoft has an on-premise hybrid strategy is what we see. So in this hybrid, in every hybrid strategy, there is a local part of IT, there is a cloud part of IT. So what Microsoft is trying to bring in local is the enterprise servers like Windows servers, and Hyper-V is the virtualization application which they have. And what they are trying to bring in the cloud side is the applications which we call middleware, which connects multiple applications together. So SharePoint, Azure platform, these are applications which are on the cloud. Now let's look at what Google is doing. Google believes that the browser and an enhanced browser like Android, which has a lot of HTML5 capabilities, is the local part of the cloud strategy. Whereas on the cloud, they will be having apps which are simpler to use, like Google Apps. Apple has a different game altogether. To them, everything is device. Their local part is device. If at all they have an operating system, that operating system is very closely connected to the device. So their cloud part is two things. One is that they have a marketplace, App Store, iTunes. Other is they have a data storage in cloud, which they have come up calling iCloud. Now you see that these three players who are competing are actually differentiating with each other. And what is a differentiator? Microsoft, they are making the middleware as a differentiator, which is on cloud. Google is making the browser as the operating system, and thereby they are getting into the mobile space. And Apple is making a device which is a differentiator in the hybrid game. Now, the question is, when we become more practical about cloud, we see that there's nothing which is absolute cloud. Cloud is a strategy which blends your requirement based on how much of IT is commoditized and can be used across multiple consumers, and how much of IT is your differentiator, where the IT is very unique for your business. So we see three elements in this ecosystem which is trying to complement cloud. There's a fourth element. And we need to talk about the element because we come from an implementation background or a services background. The question is, if today we have an ERP application on cloud, how does it work? It'll be an ERP that will run on mobile, it'll run on your devices, it'll have a host of middleware that will connect with your legacy applications. How are you going to connect these together? The problem is that for the IT admin, cloud does not simplify, it makes it more difficult. When you come up with a cloud solution which is more specialized for the business, it becomes more difficult for the IT admin to orchestrate these elements and still call it cloud. You see that a lot part of it is still services that you have to maintain internally. You still have to maintain IT staff, because 60% of your IT spend goes into implementation services where cloud does not have an answer. So does cloud take care of that 60%? Before that, let us understand how this IT ecosystem works. I talked about commoditization of IT and specialization of IT. So let us see what are the services and layers of specializations that come in this picture and how far they can be moved into cloud. So let us see the bottom most or the fundamental most element in IT. First is hardware. So once you adopt an hardware, the service that immediately comes into play is performance management. You have to manage the performance of the system, so that service you still require. Then you put a network. The added services is you need to do system integration so that you connect your network with various applications. After that, you bring in collaboration and productivity applications like email, exchange, documents. And for that, you need configuration services. On top of that, when you build your IT, you build a host of business applications which are common across your departments, like HR, payroll. When you do that, the service of data migration comes in. And then you have very niche vertical applications without the ERP for your application. For example, manufacturing systems or retail systems. In that case, a very critical service that comes in, which we call change management, where you have to help the enterprise adopt the new processes, help the people adopt the new processes. Finally, there are very niche applications like RFID and all, which differentiates your business. When it comes to differentiation, you will require consulting services. Now, TCS has been traditionally good at the right side of this parallelogram, because we come from a service background primarily, and we are trying to move into applications. But the question is that we are trying to answer is that can these applications, along with the services, which is a critical part of it, be still be called a cloud application? Our answer is that as we move into more specialized IT, you require a managed services component which has to complement the cloud. So by managed service, I mean that you need to have a services which is centralized, whether it's consulting services, implementation services, and come up with a business model where the customers can share the same services across. Unless we have a pay-per-use model for managed services, whether we call it transaction-based services or value-based services, true purpose of cloud is not served unless we move, when we move into more specialized IT applications. So, three tenets. It has to be pay-per-use all through. All the applications has to be integrated. And it has to be one-stop shop where the managed services handles all the application together. This is what we call IT as a service, where the service and the application is provided by a provider, and it is still on pay-per-use. The application is on cloud. The implementation is done through a managed services desk, which can be partly centralized and partly distributed. And this is the enterprise architecture which we follow. This is nothing to do with TCS actually, though we follow it very rigidly. It is to do with any enterprise architecture which is looking at the entire cloud application of its firm to move into the cloud paradigm. So we have a L1 layer, which is your hardware, then the network connectivity layer. On top of it, you have a collaboration layer. Then you have the common business applications like CRM, FNA, HRMS. And then you have vertical ERP applications. And then you have analytics and business services. Of course, big data is an important component of it these days. As we move up, cloud becomes even more challenging because that part of IT is unique to your business. You require a managed service component to it. So this is the kind of paradigm we are looking at for cloud. Thank you very much.
We have come to the last part of this session, and before that I'd like to thank Mr. Basu for the interesting topic. I know you might have a lot of questions which I believe you need to ask him, but excuse us, we don't have time. You can do that perhaps during the lunch recess. Okay, so now I switch over to Mr. Ganesh Iyer, who is the area sales manager or rather the regional sales manager of North and East at VMware India. In his current role, he is responsible for developing and managing the SMB business via the channel organization, formulating and implementing channel strategy and enhance revenue growth through partners for VMware in India. Well, we welcome Mr. Ganesh Iyer for the session, last part of this session today. Please. Your time is...
At the outset, thanks a lot, Bengal Chambers, Mr. Sengupta, for inviting us to present before this august audience. If the first presenter was the person standing between you and the lunch, then I believe that I'm being put to death by your eyes. I will try to wrap it up in the next 10 minutes. The topic that I have usually takes more than one and a half hours, but I'll try to wrap it up within the next 10 minutes of whatever best that I can do. What I'm going to focus upon today is a paradigm shift that we see, because the earlier two presentations were themselves a paradigm in themselves, the big data as well as the cloud, whether to go for a hybrid or in-house premise, interesting topics. To start off with, this is what we are, VMware. We have been the fix, these statistics behind us, we're the fifth largest in the world. We've got so many customers, some of them in and around Calcutta as well as across the world. We'll not spend much time onto this. What I would want to start off is with some interesting virtualization facts. The first one being that someone turns on one VM every 6 seconds, that's faster than the rate of the babies that are born in the United States of America. The second is that there are 20 million VMs that are running on VMware vSphere. So if they were on physical machines, they would be twice the length of the Great Wall of China. Third is that there are 5.5 vMotions that happen per second. So if I were to look at the lower bottom part, any given point of time, there are more VMs in motion than the planes in the air. That shows the stability of what we have to offer. And the fourth is that there are more than 68,000 VMware certified professionals across 146 countries, some of them being in august companies like TCS, IBM, who are our dearmost, topmost partners who enable us to deliver value to customers like you, without whom our existence as well as your success wouldn't be possible. Moving ahead, the challenges that we foresee in IT today is, if I were to take a realistic picture of what exactly the IT challenges are, it is a gradual curve that is going from the bottom left side to the topmost right side, which is purely in terms of the risk of downtime, because you can't afford downtime. You've already invested onto the capex, opex, and you are looking at ensuring that the business benefit doesn't get compromised. So risk of downtime is something that you always want to minimize. The space constraints, okay, that can be solved with virtualization, but then that still exists. The power, because power is becoming an increasing part of your opex, you have to budget it into your P&L. The utilization, the cost, the agility, and the agility part being very important, because the time taken for you to provision and upgrade is something that is going to eat up on you every day. Drawing a parallel in today's data centers, as we look at it, as we have seen it in our existence in the past 15 years and so, we look at it and we recognize that still the data centers are siloed in terms of a domain of Windows, a Linux, a database, a mission critical, an HPC, a big data, because each one of them have evolved over a period of time. Each one of them have contributed over a period of time to your IT infrastructure, to your business benefits, and the way that you approach your market. Because as customers, you are more interested in running your business. What contributes to you behind is something that is left back to the IT. As a business person, you are more interested in how do I run the business rather than what makes it run, because that's outsourced to the IT. And this is where we look at it. And the result that we have seen in this siloed kind of approach is the IT tends to spend more than 70% of its budget in keeping the lights on. That's just running the business, that's just keeping the heart pumping, the blood going, so that the body is moving. There isn't enough money, time, or initiative left to take up something new. Interestingly, post-virtualization and the advent of whatever are the business benefits that we had brought on in terms of virtualization, we are seeing that the VM workloads are doubling every 4 years. Initially, it was you had to take anywhere between 4 to 6 to 8 weeks to procure a physical server. Today, it's provisioning of a virtual machine at the click of a button. So the entire workload now being very easy to provision, it's getting doubled every 4 years. So what is the solution that I have? Do I double my admins? Do I double my budget? Or do I double, you know, the entire outsourcing part of it? And more importantly, is that a viable solution? Can I afford to go back to my IT management and say that this is what it is? So with these kind of challenges, and also the fact that we did a survey along with Gartner to understand what exactly are the priorities for any CIO across, you know, a period of 5 years, interesting results that it threw up. The first one being that implementing a cloud service being a SaaS, IaaS, PaaS in 2012 was relegated to number 11. The top three priorities, however, were delivering business solutions, reducing the cost of IT, and developing or managing a flexible infrastructure. Because the accountability of the IT person from an internal perspective was to ensure that the business doesn't suffer. So from his perspective, it was relegated to 11th spot, and the top three priorities on which he had to spend time were these. And our challenge then drilled down to, how do we marry this to the business requirements, to the goals of the CIO? What we foresee today in terms of the way the industry is shaping, because we believe that the industry is currently in a very tipping point kind of a moment. We have seen virtualization come. We have seen virtualization come and add value in terms of reducing the capex, opex, etc., etc. But then that's history. What we see the industry moving towards is something which is known as, what else do I do beyond the server part of it? So earlier, if server virtualization was what was getting me the kind of economies of scale, the revenues, because I am able to, you know, do more with the same investment, so on and so forth, that's history now, that's passé. What we're looking at is virtualizing your entire data center. And when I mean a data center, it is something that the entire hardware going forward in the next 12, 18 months would be controlled by a software layer. So just like earlier you had a server which was virtualized, going forward you would have a concept, you would have a working model by which you would have a complete data center which is abstracted in terms of the network, in terms of the storage, in terms of the security, in terms of the security policies, be it HIPAA or anything else, that's completely virtualized and controlled by the software layer. So all you're bothered about is, how fast can I provision a virtual data center? If I were to define it in a more simplistic term, what I would say is that all the infrastructure is completely virtualized and delivered as a service. The most important part being that it is being delivered as a service. Because as an IT person or as a business person, what you are looking at is, what is the service that I am getting? If I need to launch a new application, and if I need these things to be in place, how soon can I do? Time is of essence. What is the time to market for me to get down with the new applications? I'm least bothered about what is the time it is taking for you to get the hardware, security, hardening provisioned. Drawing the actual lines. In 2008, we did a survey. It used to take you around weeks to provision a server. In 2012, it reduced from a server provisioning to provisioning of virtual machine in days. And virtual machine in days happens because actually you can provision a virtual machine at the right click of a button between anywhere between 2 to 4 hours maximum. But the allied infrastructure that you see on the top of your screen, which is the storage availability, the servers, the networking, the security hardening, monitoring, etc., is the time that gets contributed so that your virtual machine is completely secured. You are not releasing it to the end user without securing it in lines with your IT policies. And the way we see the IT industry move is, going forward, you will be able to provision your entire virtual data center in terms of minutes. So how it marries is, the topmost layer also gets controlled by the software, and you as an IT admin or as an IT thought leader are completely abstracted of what is lying underneath. All you're going to focus upon is, how do I deliver the service? If I were to draw an analogy, a very rough analogy in a layman term, 1795 was the year when supply chain management got revolutionized by the introduction of containerization. What it meant was, you have an oblong box of container, and inside that you might be carrying, let's say, a consignment of potatoes, you might be carrying livestock, but then this can be distributed across railways, roads, shipment, or airlifted. It brought in a degree of standardization. It also